well, that's not quite strictly true. I've done the odd period of working for somebody else. But largely, I've worked for myself. Now, I don't have an awful lot of money to show for it. In fact, I'm probably the poorest of the three political leaders on the bench. So don't get running away with the idea that all Conservatives are fat cats. We certainly aren't. But certainly, I've worked for myself. And that's an opportunity that's available to you as well. You have been educated, or are being educated, to a very high standard. Many of you have just started doing vocational design courses as well. You can work for yourselves. It's not easy, it's not fun, but it's an option. The answer often lies in your hands. Don't assume it lies waiting for some foreign investment to come in and then you can beat a path to the door and you'll be the only one picked up. You can actually work for yourselves and you can actually get a lot of satisfaction out of it that way.
Thank you, Councillor Ruff.
Thank you, Simon. Just in terms of issue around job decisions, I personally think also a great place to live and it's a great place to work. I'm sure many of you do too as well. And we need to make sure that people do have the opportunity to work in the city. Now for me, that's twofold. That is around encouraging businesses, the major corporates and the like, to come here and invest here. Siemens is a good example of this, but I think there's more to come. There has to be more to come. You can't just rely on Siemens itself. There has to be more that comes this way as well. Well, other companies as well. And on the side, a bit like Councillor Ferner says, I think there is something around actually entrepreneurs. I think the council, but other businesses and business groups need to do more to encourage entrepreneurism in this city and actually help people to set up their own businesses, help people to start those small and medium enterprises. Because actually, the SMEs are normally what provide the most employment. It's not the big companies, it is small to medium enterprises that actually are vital to providing jobs in the city. And by the way, I have a son and it'd be great for me if he could invest in his time and how much work in the city. But likewise, I want him to have the skills to be able to get a job wherever he can get a job, so that it fulfills him. So I think actually, yes, it's about making sure there's employment opportunities here. It's also about giving people the skills to get employment where they want to get employment. That could be here, it could be London, it could be abroad. So let's think big on this. Yes, let's make sure there are jobs and opportunities here, but actually the important thing is to make sure people have the skills to get a job wherever they want to get a job. I think that's important. Just on the graduates, Hull has a very high retention rate of graduates, which is surprising when you get to how few graduate jobs there are actually in the city, which I think for me shows that how vibrant the city is and how attractive the city is for people to stay and live here and work here.
Okay, thank you, councillors. Okay, the opportunity to students. Anybody got any comments, would like to say something? Aline, let's stand up first.
I'd just like to address the fact that homelessness has become increased incredibly. So, and not to mention the fact that there's barely any businesses on their own in Hull anymore. So how can you say it's getting better at all?
Thank you. Sorry, could you just tell us who you are, please, sorry?
Katie Broom.
Thank you, Katie. Who would like to respond?
Certainly, I beg to differ on that one. The changes that are occurring are for the future, and as I said, there will be many new businesses, small businesses, getting the benefits of Siemens coming, and certainly the small contractors and such. They say for every job that a manufacturer like Siemens brings, four more come in the supply chain. So you're talking roughly about 5,000 jobs. At the moment, I think the unemployment's just fallen to about 6,500 from a much higher figure. But in terms of real jobs, Siemens have actually guaranteed that 99% of their employees will come from Hull and the surrounding area. I do think it's always difficult. When I started work at 15 and I had failed the 11 plus, it was difficult to get a job. So I went riding a carrier bike for a butcher. And I did that, riding that carrier bike for 3 years on a cropped old bike. And certainly from that, I went and worked as a labourer in a power station.
gonna do is fight like hell against why opportunities out there. And as I said, all along the way from the 50s, from my memory time anyway, from the 50s to now, there's been the same struggles generation after generation. So life ain't easy, but what we're trying to do in using my experience from that, being one of 14 in a three-bedroom house, so I'm not talking as some snotty-nosed Tory young who's living in some bloody big mansion in London. I'm talking about now, as what, second from the experience I've had, to where the situation is now. So with that experience, I'm thinking I want to try to make things better for the people in the city and for the young people. No, it'll never be Shangri-La. We'll never get the perfect thing. But what you can do is always keep trying to improve life for the people around you.
Thank you, Councillor Brady. Cameron, you wanted to say something? Do you want to stand up, sir? Yes, please.
I'm currently working on a lecture at Hull College. I teach predominantly foundation studies, which are entry-level learners. Councillor Brady has just highlighted a list of entry-level jobs, those that don't need any skills. Could you tell me, please, in the city, where are those jobs now? Where are my students that are working very hard going to progress to?
Is that to Councillor Brady in particular?
Councillor Brady, because he mentioned a number of entry-level jobs.
Well, I suppose the type of jobs I started off was pretty low skill. All you needed to do was be able to ride a bike. I suppose the low skill type work is your McDonald's, but there's certainly shop jobs, and office jobs. Well, there must be, there's jobs available in this city, if, it depends what level you want to go in at, doesn't it? Every job has got a minimum pay cut of, what is it, 650, going up to 720 next year. So, wherever you get employment, it is not good enough, but there's still jobs available if you're willing to look for them.
Thank you. Any further comments from students? Yes, so you've got to stand up first, say who you are, please.
I'm Ross McEwen. I was saying, you're saying there's loads of jobs and that it's at loads of different levels. They're not necessarily there. I work at KC, doing waiting food, I get paid just over £4 an hour and do about 5 hour shifts.
What area is that, sorry? What area of work are you talking about?
Catering.
Catering?
Yeah, so that's entry level. But I would not be able to live off just over £4 an hour. That'd be impossible. In fact, get 4 shifts a month as well.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You can't necessarily say it's just hard work. If you do get a job, you're not getting the money that you need.
So are you saying you'd welcome the living wage that's being introduced?
Well, I'd say yeah.
I'm going from the land that we stopped at home, so obviously we didn't have the costs associated with being in a flat or a house. No, you couldn't live on that, I totally accept it. So, and I do, it certainly, I don't think there's any intention of raising up to the minimum wage or the living wage for people under a certain age, which to me is farcical. I think it should be from 18, certainly that wage level should be there.
Can I just on the living wage aspect, I think you bring in the concept of living wage. Well, let's not be fooled though, in terms of what George Osborne tries to propose around the living wage, it's not the living wage. He's really just talking about bringing the minimum wage up a bit, and he's tasking it as the minimum wage. It's not a trick by politicians. If you call it something, people think it is. Well, no, it isn't, actually. But you didn't jump last point. You didn't. You simply put up the minimum wage, but it's not minimum wage. The real minimum wage would have to be a couple of times more an hour, and that is not what's happening. And I think people need to, you know, really, you know, hold them to account for this. I'm welcome going up there in a while, I think that's good, but it's not the innovation, we need to be clear about that. In terms of the jobs in the city, actually, I think one of the ones about this, there are jobs out there, but not necessarily easy to find for us. I think we at least more work done. And there was, as Steve says, the jobs fair for humans, jobs fair here, but actually, there needs to be more of that. There needs to be more job fairs taking place in the city to actually just help people access those jobs that do exist.
Thank you. Okay, any other student would like to make a comment? Yes, thank you. Could you stand up, please, and say who you are?
This question is for Councillor from the Conservative Party, don't break action room. With what you said about working for yourself, I just mentioned the percentage of business startups that fail within the first year is around 80%. What financial security do your entrepreneurs have if they are to invest their own startup capital in their business?
Thank you. Who is that, Councillor
Gray? Yes. You're absolutely right. There is a high percentage that fail, and many of them are multiple failures. And I actually agree with you that that's why we support the fund that the leader does, which is the Young Entrepreneurs Scheme that the council runs. And I certainly think that the major problem, not just for young entrepreneurs, but also for many businesses, is the ridiculous lending practices, or more often than not, actually not lending practices, of the clearing banks. That's why I'm actually a great supporter of things like the cooperative movement, like credit unions, because the major four clearing banks in this country are so fossilised in their lending policy that if they don't understand it, they won't take a chance. Now, if you go to somewhere like Germany, where they have guild banks, which actually understand the industry that they're in, because that's what they're allied to. They're not about making money per se, they're about supporting and investing in business. So there's a lot of things that need changing. And certainly when I set up my first business, which by the way did fail after 5 years, it was because I couldn't get money from the banks. And I was only trying to sell books, for heaven's sake, which is hardly a sort of high-tech, low-risk thing. So the second idea was making wooden toys. Funny that one took off and actually worked. You can never tell how it should be. But you are right, it is hard. But so what? As the leader says, life ain't easy. You fail, you pick yourself up again, and hopefully with friends, family, and other people that you've made along the way, and the resilience of a good education, you can try again. But no, I'm not saying it's easy, and you figure it's absolutely right, but that's my answer. And I certainly would expand on where the leader has taken this council.
Thank you. Any other students? Comments, please? Okay, so, again, back to red and green cards. Show of cards, if you think the question's been answered. You've all got cards. Much better. Well done, colleagues. Well done. Okay, thank you. We'll move on to the next question. And I'd like to invite student Jack Carr, please.
Is there a crisis in mental health service provision and support? Because currently 1 in 4 of the population experiences a mental health problem, and there's a growing awareness of the needs of young people. What do you as the party feel needs to be achieved to ensure people are able to access the appropriate support?
Thank you, Jack. Excellent question, one that's pertinent. I'd like to invite Councillor Ross to start us off, please.
One of the biggest problems around mental health service is that, in large part, you can't see it. So you can't see generally that people have mental health problems. I think this is the problem with service, isn't it? It's about raising awareness of the issue. Now, Nick Kev, not the most universally popular people, I understand, but when he became leader of the Democrats, the first question he asked in the MPs was about mental health provision. And people thought, well, what a strange issue to be asking the question. Why on earth are you raising this issue in the MPs? Isn't there more important things to be talked about? But he saw the importance then of this issue. And when we came into government, working with Norman Allen, who was our health minister, we pushed and pushed this issue to make sure that it became an important issue, one that the funding was put in place for. But actually, I think, generally for me, it is a matter of raising awareness of the issue is the important thing here. As the question says, 1 in 4 of the population, how many other conditions, illnesses, or whatever you want to call it, affect 1 in 4 of the population? I think that is a demonstration of how important this issue is. So anything that can be done to raise the awareness of it. And I think also just on the funding, the funding does need to be there. Funding needs to be there for the NHS. I use the NHS from time to time quite a lot for a number of different reasons, and I see for myself the difficulties that people have to access the health service in general, regardless of what the issue is. For something so impossible as mental health condition, we need to make sure that actually can be speeded. And that's one of the points of limit. It is necessary to get people through the system and get that support in place that needs to be. So anything that raises it up the agenda, anything that gets that support in place needs to happen.
Councillor Farron?
Yes, I agree with Mike. I think detail was quite heroic on it. And of course, we owe a lot as well to Alistair Campbell, who has always sort of been quite open about the fact he had a mental breakdown. And it's interesting to be the trilogy. I'll admit that when I went through a divorce, lost my parents and lost my seat all within 6 months, it wasn't exactly the best time for me, as far as I will go on that point. Yes, you're right, Mike, you probably did start the band wagon rolling when you were in government. As a result, perhaps of that, and as a result of our own inherent beliefs, we've introduced the Crisis Care Concordat in 2014. We have the Mental Health Priorities for Change, which we're pushing through Parliament at the moment. And of course, part of our plans, as you say, Mike, and Mike's too modest to mention, but his father actually certainly was a GP, so Mike will know quite a bit about this from him. It's worth pushing forward for the 7-day NHS, and God knows how that's going to happen, and whether it will happen with the entrenched, if Mike will forgive me, with the entrenched attitudes in the NHS. I always remember Nye Bevan, if you want change, stuff the GP's mouths with gold, was his answer to it. But at least we're having a crack at trying to do that, which is your point about access. Certainly as well, there's a role for councils and local health authorities, making sure the provision is there, that the access for it isn't just tucked away at the back of a building where you can be instantly stigmatised, because people, unfortunately, in society, for some reason, some people in society do tend to stigmatise those who have mental health issues. So I think it's important to make sure it's not just tucked around the back, so everybody goes, oh, look where he's going, everybody can actually just get a direct walk-in from the streets, and access like that. So there's a way to go yet, but I think the wheels have started. I think, to be fair, all parties are. I can't remember because, frankly, I don't pay much attention to shadow cabinets, which are just a collection of people trying to pretend they're important. But I believe that Jeremy Corbyn sent out a message. I think he's created a mental health shadow person, hasn't he, Steve? I think it has, which again, whilst you can always say the titles are titles, at least it's moving up the agenda. And I think it shows that all three political parties are aware of this. As Mike says, as you put in your question, it's an incredible figure, 1 in 4. But I will refute the phrase crisis. I think that's just an overused word. I think it's a problem, it's a long-standing problem, and finally it's being tackled.
Thank you. On to Councillor Brady, I guess 1 in 4 would suggest that there probably isn't a person in the room who hasn't either been affected or directly affected by mental health issues, or they know somebody or a family member. That's the extent of what we're talking about when it comes to people with mental health problems. Councillor Brady?
It could be greater than that, I think. Because I don't think there's a lot of people go through life and you start to oppose it, and that's one of the problems that mental health seems that a lot of people does bring out for. I think there's sometimes really inadequate how they feel, so a lot of it's personal, and I don't think there's many families where someone isn't suffering from mental health. And of course, it can be because there's so many conditions or so many things leading up to it, the pressures of different things that actually lead to a point where you know you're ill yourself and you know that you need, you need to do something about it. And the best thing to do, I've got a brother who's a mental health nurse, and he said talking to him and bringing out all the problems, because all the problems seem a lot bigger. They're all blown out of proportion to how things really are, and I don't think in the past doctors have particularly understood it well. They'll just give antidepressants or interesting in the media just recently where provision suddenly brought back into the city. So yeah, it is a big problem, and I do think it's probably partly given what the biggest to be.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from students? Thank you, yes, stand up and again, please, wherever you are.
Hi, it's from Ewan. To access mental health care as a 16-year-old, you have to go through as a child. Are any of the parties planning on doing anything about that? Because, you know, having experienced that, it was an entirely inappropriate experience.
Sorry, can I just ask you to clarify? Are you saying you went through as a child into adult services?
No, as a 16-year-old, seeking like help for mental health issues, I had to go through as a child. Like, I had to bring my mum along and fill out a questionnaire asking whether or not I played well with other children. I was a 16-year-old suffering depression. That was entirely inappropriate.
Okay.
Are any of the parties planning on doing anything about that?
Okay, thank you. Would you like to?
I think it's more to do with, really, what you've expressed about the time 16, you know, they probably don't even want to talk to your parents about it. You want to talk to someone, probably, you know, parents being involved. And I think that's more for the health service to address.
Yeah. I think unfortunately you're a child of 18
years old. They tend not to get involved in that. And the health providers, it's something that we will talk about, our own well-being board, and I'm raising that as to what they can do. But I'm quite surprised actually that, you know, that young people don't have that provision to go and see someone without the parents knowing about it, because I believe of contraception. Sometimes the parents don't know that the young people are getting contraception, so I'm surprised in mental health that that's happening.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your comment. Any other comments? Students, mental health? Yes, please.
Just going back to what was said earlier by the Conservative Council, you said that it wasn't a crisis for people who were affected by mental health. You recognised it as a problem. He then went on to say that that problem was being tackled. I'd just like to know how cutting funding for something so important is tackling an issue.
I'm not aware that we are cutting funding on this. If we're introducing new legislation, we're actually promising to back that up with which the bill, as I've seen, and I must admit I've only read the briefing sheet on it, so I haven't actually read the bill itself, but as we're actually putting in more money and more services, I don't accept your point that we're cutting it.
Thank you. Any further comments? Mental health? Okay, thank you. We're going to move on. And our next question comes from student Paris Hilton, please.
Student
at Hull College. I'm just wondering how the Party is going to ensure that our 2017 CC Fortress
inspires the new generation and leaves a lasting legacy on the city of Cyrus Community. And I'd like to thank you. I'd like to start with Councillor Brady, please. Well, there'll be announcements very shortly by Martin Green, who runs the who's the chief exec of the culture company. And he's going to bring an accreditation scheme in, and they will be seeking volunteers to act as hosts to the visitors to this city during that 2017 year. And every person going through that and being a volunteer, as what happened at the Olympic Games, will receive that accreditation for that year of activity, which I believe will be a real boost to students who take part in that as part of their CV, to be able to either carry on in that type of work, because you never know where it leads you to, being involved in a great year and great events that are going to certainly there'll be contacts with all the schools, the colleges and such, to be involved in one way or another. And we want that the culture to leave a lasting legacy through all the estates in the city, so that everybody feels they've had and played a part in that year. And the success of it will depend on how many people in the city feel that it's touched them on their estates, in their areas and such as that. So he has got a very, very difficult job, but he's got a great team around him. He's got great ideas, and certainly one of the major, major things he wants to do is involving young people of this city to be part and parcel of delivering those great things.
Thank you. Before I move on to Councillor Ross, can I just maybe have a show of hands of students that might be interested in volunteering during the City of Culture Year?
You're not a student?
I am.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay.
So, students not interested in volunteering during the City of Culture?
BBC, for example, who are part of City Culture in the small way, I'm sure, Actually, I'm not struggling to encourage people to come to Hull, because city culture, the attraction of city culture to people to come here and be part of it is already there. So, what do we need to make sure? We need to make sure that that impression, that image of city is not just about 2017, but it's about Hull itself, and leaves actually that last impression of the city being a great place to come, a great place to visit, a great place to work, a great place to live. City culture's past that is not the only answer to that, but it has to be used as a catalyst to actually turn the impression, this image of the city around, so people do actually want to be part of Hull.
Thank you. It might interest students to know that during the summer 12 Olympics, we had a significant number of volunteers who went down to London and volunteered during the whole of the Olympics programme. So that might be something that you want to think about for 2017 in terms of City of Culture. Councillor Farrow?
I can, but I have a question in two halves. Firstly, it's about how would the parties inspire regeneration through City of Culture. It's not our job. That's what Martin Green and his team is for. We might have some input into what he does, but that is him and his leadership team who have to actually inspire the generations. That's what the delivery vehicle has been set up for. That is not actually our job. As politicians, we created the framework of the whole city culture ethos. We've got it into the city. But from there on in, we hand over. It's a capital mistake to assume that it, whatever it may ever be, the answer is the council. It isn't. The answer is actually you. And we just really facilitate and enable. But to take the second part, the leave a lasting legacy in the city, yes, that is something that we actually do have a stake in. Because it can't escape your notice that the entire City of Culture bandwagon programme, whatever, never goes to Kensington and Chelsea, Windsor and Maidenhead, Esher, or all the rest of the places that my colleagues like to wax on about being leafy. They always go to the sort of Rotherhams and Alls and that sort of place. I don't have to be to Rotherham yet, it's only a matter of time. Why? The reason is, it's a significant amount of money that is spent, it's a significant amount of media focus, as Mike says. Why are they coming to the BBC in Hull rather than the BBC in Leicester? Why are they coming to the BBC in Kensington? It's because you can get the status of saying, I was there, the City of Culture here, and it's on your CV, and it helps you fast track. And that's good, that's what it's about. It's about making sure that there is continuous investment. And part of our legacy, and the leaders referred to it earlier, is stuff like doing the public realm, you know, making the pavements of the city centre and others look somewhat less dated than they actually are. And the reason that we're getting to do that is because there's money available on the grounds that we're on the back of the City of Culture. Suddenly, governments start putting a little bit more money our way, the council's in a better position to borrow money or do any other funding mechanism the leader chooses to use. And that's our job as political parties, is to make sure that the physical bricks and mortar, the physical environment is lifted at the same time as all the arts, performances and everything else. So there will undoubtedly be, and I agree with Steve, it's got to be across the city, it can't just be in the city centre. So that's our role as the parties, but it's not to inspire the generation. But our job is to make sure that the generations have actually got a platform, and a good platform, to build from in the physical sense of the city.
Thank you. Student comments, please. Who would like to say anything about City of Culture? Thank you. Can I stand up, please?
Hello, my name is Carlos. The original draw that reputation of Hull remains positive after 2017 and 2018 onwards.
Is there anybody you'd like in particular like that question to go to?
I've got three.
Councillor Brent, please.
I'd be really disappointed if after 2017, in fact, you can't see how 2017 would be seen as a success. If everything goes back to normal in 2018 or 2019. In fact, what we are aiming to is to not finish the programme at the end of 2017, but it actually stretches into 2018. And, you know, we are looking to bring this new, things like this new music arena that's going to
come into Hull, or at least satisfy the things that we want to do and want to see in the city centre. So it'll be much more vibrant in the city centre. At the moment, it's pretty dead, isn't it? Monday to Thursday, I mean, it's pretty dour. It's only the weekends that anything really comes to life. And you go to a lot of other cities and people tend to spend more time. People who work in the city centre spend more time in the city centre, having something to eat, having a drink or whatever, into the evening. Hull's population, by and large, just goes on. I think maybe it's because of the tight boundaries, it might be easier to just get on the bus and go on and maybe go a lot where you don't want at all much. But we do need to change that. And certainly the feeling in Hull, because there's so many talents on the music scene in Hull that's coming to the fore now, that really it should inspire a lot of people to actually follow suit from those big acts that will be coming. Because a lot of it, look at the local music scene as well, 2017, but actually, a lot of careers could certainly have better prospects after the 2017 in music because they're going to have much bigger audience. So, yes, we need for it to be the start of something big for Hull rather than just a one-off event.
Yes, just briefly, I think the benefit that Hull has as opposed to is that Hull can learn from their experience of city culture. My understanding is their city culture year, although I think Barnard House was a very good show, it was basically one that was bought in and just hosted there. It wasn't so much about the place and about the people there, it was just commissioned and put on as that stage, but no one lasting effect on the place. And whereas Hull can learn from that experience and say, actually, we don't want that, we want to make sure that this is of benefit to the city rather than just a good show. And can learn from that space to make sure those mistakes that happen there aren't repeated here.
Thank you. Any further comments from students on City of Culture and the legacy? Okay, I forgot this last time, apologies. So to our cards, do you think that councillors have answered our question? Are you sure, please? You're getting better? You're getting better? Please say no. Thank you. Okay, moving on, we're doing well for time. I would like to invite Alan Smith to ask the next question.
With the increased availability of legal power, especially for young people, how do the parties propose to tackle this growing problem in our community?
Can we start with Councillor Ferrin?
Gee, thanks. I thought that the psychoactive substances bill, which we just introduced, was a good start. But, you know, I'm never convinced about legislation. And I'm never convinced it's always the answer. For those of us who remember Prohibition, which basically just enshrined the mob in American politics because they made so much money out of it, they managed to corrupt their entire system, frankly. I think that largely for me, it's about making sure that people are aware of what the risks are of taking any substance, be it alcohol, tobacco, and partially the odd drink, I have to say. And booze at the moment still kills and causes more costs to the public purse than the so-called legal highs. So I think that on this one, I'm going to plead the Fifth Amendment. I've certainly never engaged in any of this. But we have started tackling it, and on this one I'm going to toe the party line and say I think we're actually probably getting it right.
Thank you. Councillor Brady?
I must confess I don't know much about legal eyes. The only legal eye I get is when I beat the niece to win the council chamber or in the local elections. But I think my advice to people is to certainly avoid anything that's actually dependent on something for a long period of life, or what can destroy your lives. And those misery books is Songs from Your Fathers. I think maybe everybody takes something in terms of a drink or whatever to take them away from the realities of life itself, I suppose. The dangers of getting into dependency, particularly on drugs, I mean, it's just something that people shouldn't get into. It's an evil thing that's, that can take over people's lives and destroy them very, very quickly. Obviously, such as alcohol and such, again, in small or reasonable quantities, we all know what our limit should be, we all know when we've gone so far. And I suppose in life everybody's got vices. Nobody's pure in the way that they can start preaching to anyone else. You know, I wish I'd never started smoking. You know, it's one of those things that's cost huge amount of money. It ain't good for your health, but it's personal responsibility. I've nobody else to blame but myself.
Thank you. Perhaps there's also something here in the question around, as well as shops that might sell it in the high street, there's something about the internet and how the internet is used to fuel what is that very problem, easily obtainable costs and so forth.
In a sense, what you're talking about is that accessibility of these products. I think that is a concern. But for me, actually, I think this is a much broader issue. They've always had a very odd name, such as legal highs, because it's kind of a misnomer in terms of what they really are. And I think actually the danger of this is that we sort of separate them from the broader drugs debate and drugs issue. Now, Councillor Fenn and Councillor Gray both talk about alcohol and drugs. I personally don't smoke, and I'm a big drinker, but they're both legal activities, and it's perfectly acceptable to do so. But again, they have major impacts on your life if you go to excess. Drugs fall in different categories. Drugs are not legal. Now, that's not to say that there aren't people that use them. And yeah, that has an impact on most people's lives. And I think there needs to be a bit of debate here in terms of drugs issues themselves. That's something that Richard Branson and along with Nick Clegg is actually pushing up the agenda, because there does need to be that discussion take place around what is and isn't acceptable. Personally speaking, I don't like drugs. I haven't never used drugs. I wouldn't want to use drugs. I think they are dangerous. I think they have a bad impact on your life. That's not to say there shouldn't be a discussion around what is acceptable, because actually, the amount of money that gets spent on drugs issue, be it whether helping people with sport or the criminal aspects of it, is tremendous, and there needs to be a better way of tackling this issue in the long term. I don't profess to know what the answer is, but I think the problem for me is this is one of those issues that falls into the category of, well, we really should talk about it. It's a very dangerous issue to talk about. It's a real stigma issue, or it's a really sort of politically costly issue. But actually, we need to be upfront and be able to have that debate in an open manner to come forward with the answers that actually do help both those who are using and those who are affected by these issues, be it legal highs or drugs in general.
Okay, thank you. Comments from students, please. Legal highs. Nobody wants to make it. Oh, please, stand up.
I'd say that you're talking about legal highs, but more often not legal highs are a lot more dangerous than marijuana or for that.
Thank you, it's a good point, well made, thank you. Any other comments? Okay. So, if we have a show of our cards again, please, do we think that question's been answered? Okay, but answer your rapid, yes. Okay, thank you. Okay, we're doing well for time, so we're moving on to our final question now for today. And I'd like to invite student Ross McEwen, please. Oh, dear.
With the current migration crisis in the Mediterranean and elsewhere, what should UK's response be? And will the party representatives consider taking a Syrian family into their own homes? I didn't prepare this.
Councillor Brady to start us off, please.
Well, I think anybody see what's happening in the Mediterranean can only feel for those families and those people. It's terrible. I think it feels a sense of helplessness is to, you know, it could be us. It could have been us. We live by and large in certain countries, but it's only an accident of birth that we're here. We could have very well been born in Syria. It's a small place, it's the world, and children, and families, and their thoughts, and their aspirations are no different to anybody in Hope. And it's interesting that although everybody says, well, yeah, it's terrible, but we don't want to be here. I think the German Chancellor has been very brave in what she's done, and she just opened the borders up because nobody else would. And over 1.5 million have gone over to Germany. And our response from this country has been quite pathetic. And we are a nation, actually, of immigrants. The family that I come from in the past came over in the potato famine in Ireland. And they ended up being navvies, labourers, working on the docks, building the docks, building the roads. And they did get a good reception. And again, where did they settle? They settled in the area where the new immigrants are settling, and the Springbank, Newland Avenue, these quite big Irish communities that came there, and Jewish people fleeing oppression. And I would imagine if you go back to every person in this room's ancestral room, that would be one native English person in this room. So we're all immigrants. Would I take anyone in? Well, of course, on a temporary basis, I think, you know, you want to do all you can to help. I think having families settle in their own place is the right thing to do. I don't think anybody could or would want to have two or three families living in one household. It just doesn't work. But certainly on a temporary basis, I want, alongside a lot of other people, to be able to do anything they could to get people to settle in this city.
Thank you, Councillor Ross.
Thank you. The question is framed in terms of the migration crisis. I think actually we need to be clear, there's two issues. There's migration issues, but there's also refugees. And I think actually there is a difference between the two. I think I make that point because in a sense, actually, if we look at what's happened in Syria, and it's like that is very much a refugee crisis in my book, and I think actually we need to be mindful of that. And I think the support of places like HUD has been great in this issue, in the sense that if you look at whole health refugees, which was spontaneously set up amongst the community, and it's people themselves, not waiting for the public sector to take lead, but people themselves to lead on how they can help. And I think that's really encouraging to see. I think HUD has a great history in terms of how it has helped people in the past, and that should be something that continues and happens today. As Councillor Brady says, you know, people come here from many other places fleeing persecution and being welcomed in the city. And you look at the response the city, I think the Freedom Festival, there was a petition went now, and thousands of people signed it because they wanted to see more done to help on the refugee crisis. And that really got out there as a rally as well, where many people attended. And you contrast that with the reaction, I think, a group called Hull is Full, which are protesting against the idea of more people coming here. The reaction they've had has been one of scorn, really, because they've been recognised that the response they've taken is wrong and shameful. The other side of it, in terms of the response the country should give this issue, actually, I actually agree with Councillor Brady, so I think the response from the government. it's been pitiful in terms of the 20,000 over 5 years. And to answer the question around would I take a family in, well actually, on the council, I don't need to. And I'll tell you why, because 20,000 over 5 years, what that creates in reality what we'll see in terms of senior families coming to this city before Christmas, it's not 10, it's not 100, it's not 1,000. It most likely will be about one. One family coming to home before Christmas. And when you look at those images of the persecution they're facing there, and let's not forget this has not just been going on over this summer, it's been going on for years. The fact that we'll see just one family being housed in Hull before Christmas, I think is actually shocking. I think more does need to be done to actually help those people who are being persecuted, whether it be from Syria or elsewhere. And I think more can be done. I think the response has been shown to be lacking. And that response in itself is only pain because the government felt the pressure they did after initial response from Cameron and others of, no, we won't take anybody. I think let's keep that pressure up and let's get a better response to the situation.
Thank you, Councillor Burrow.
I think I'd like to nuance the fact that there are two different issues around it. One is economic migration and one is genuine refugee asylum seeking. I think on the subject of asylum seeking, you probably couldn't put a cigarette paper between the colleagues and myself. As I say, Hull's always done it. It's right that we should do it where there's a clear, where there's a clear case. And I think it's also important to remember that Europe, for all its patronising waffle about the rest of the world, is actually rather unique. We, as Steve said, we are largely settled, we are largely stable, and we take certain things for granted that the rest of the world would look on with some degree of considerable envy. And therefore it is right that we should be a home for refugees for asylum, and I feel support that. On migration, so I'm not prepared to wear a hair shirt and flagellate the government on this one. Let's look at this as a world problem. When I was young, we used to be rather pretentious and call ourselves citizens of the world, and the world was a global village, which was a complete joke then. Of course, now with the internet and whatnot, it seems to be becoming more true, ironically. Let's look at a world response to what is this. The French, with that ultimate of French cynicism, give you free railway travel to anybody who's an economic migrant to help them get across and make sure they can come to Britain. Don't do anything yourselves, just make sure you can pass it on. The Germans are no exception, as Castle Brady says, but the Germans have always had a good record of what they're called Gastarbeiten since about the 1960s. The Germans, for some reason, have been very outward-going about that, and it may have something to do with the fact that for so long theirs was the economic engine room of Europe. I don't know. Let's look at the response of places like Saudi. Let's look at the response of many other, where you might think the religious point of view might encourage them to actually show some compassion towards their fellow celebrants. Zero. Absolutely zero. And putting up the barriers. So I'm not going to take any flagellation. This is something that we've had this discussion. I don't think the leader would mind me saying when Councillor Lewis was trying to get a cross-party consensus on a motion that we could pass in the chamber. And Councillor Inglis and I were battling around and disagreeing on the fact that I wanted to see in the motion that the UN had a role to take in this. The UN's been remarkably quiet and supine, to say the very least. And I happen to be an internationalist. I happen to do believe that the UN should exist and it's got a role to play. It hasn't done that. I happen to believe that we should actually make sure there's a measured response. Because it's not just about remove people being economically migrating from Syria. It's also about making sure that the problems that are making them leave Syria are sorted, which is a water shortage, which of course is the war there, and these are things that we could take a moral lead on instead of just reacting. It's a fundamental belief of mine in politics, go to first principles, and the first principle is who would want to live in Syria? So let's make Syria better rather than just trying to move people around. And to answer the last question, to slightly adapt to Leader's earlier answer, I'm not a snotty-nosed Labour person living in a mansion with two kitchens. My house is so falling apart at the moment that I'm not even living in it myself, so no, I wouldn't take it in my home. I'm living in a one-bedroom flat on Beverly Road at the moment.
Okay, thank you. You've heard the views of the councillors. Any comments on our final question? Yes, would you like to stand up, please?
In terms of Europe in general, just because Merkel says it's a good idea to open the borders does not mean that the people think it's a good idea. For example, the mass protests that seem to have been overlooked just now, that the people clearly don't want the saturation of their own culture. As a schoolgirl that was told she wasn't allowed to wear a short skirt because it might offend Muslims, that's a bit ridiculous considering it's not her culture and it's not her problem. So as a people in England, is that not something we should worry about, some sort of cultural saturation?
So you're worried about cultural saturation?
Yeah.
Okay.
I take the view that our culture is not multi but monotheist, because we actually are Christian in theory, we actually are believers in a certain code. But I think it's such a strong culture that we can actually absorb and benefit from other inputs. We have everything from Huguenots onwards have made us, as Steve said, we're all immigrants. I'm not quite sure about that. I tracked my family down to 1600 and I've never seen to wander much beyond Yorkshire. But as it happens, I think that we are benefited from taking other ideas. I mentioned earlier about the internet. Well, you know, this idea that there's only a sort of little England approach, where you can just go online and go on Google and you can see what you can walk down the streets of Baghdad if you want to. I mean, it's just incredible. The world has become a global village. Yes, I think there is probably a tipping point in theory, and certainly you'll have to bid the French seem to think so, with their rather colourful attitudes towards banning people wearing burqas and whatnot. I don't think we've reached that position yet, but I certainly think that in the micro sense, we'd have to be careful, in the sense that if you suddenly took, say, 60,000 refugees in Hull in one fell swoop, of course that would have an impact on the services that we offer, but we ain't anywhere near that situation yet.
Thank you.
I'd add to that as well, in the sense of actually, we need to recognise that migration, I know there's a debate about how much it has, but broadly, it seems to be seen as a beneficial thing to the country. You look in terms of the wealth and jobs that are created through it, you look in terms of services that people from migration provide. The NHS would collapse if we didn't have a better migration in this country. It would collapse, and let's not forget that, because actually, you know, we rely on Martin's coming in, filling jobs in NHS. And there's this whole idea around, they're coming in, taking jobs from people who live it. It's broadly being dismissed as actually not true. And I think, the first problem with this is it comes down to fear of misinformation, and actually we need to tackle that rather than just saying migration is a bad thing.
Okay, thank you. Any further comments? Yes, in front of you.
I just need to make a point, like, we've got so many British people out there on the streets homeless now, and my family's had a few situations of that, and I'm not proud of it, but if we was able to solve this situation and was able to bring Syrians over, would we still be able to cope with the number of British people that are out there now?
Okay, so the question is around whether we're doing enough at the moment to support British people who are in a difficult situation, okay?
And one I'm quite happy to try and answer in part. One of them, you're taking the national figures, and you're right that there have been an increase in homeless, but it varies from area to area. For example, at the moment, and I don't believe in those, I don't know what the whole homeless figures are, I'm afraid, I won't pretend I do, but there are plenty of accommodation providers who are shifting out of the student accommodation market and sitting on empty houses in the ward that Mike largely represents, if he doesn't mind me saying so, who actually are quite prepared to take in asylum seekers because they need to keep their income flow going. We all name Unicom and various others. And we've seen that happen before in the last wave of migration, which was from the Kurds. Now, if we've got those houses empty, and if we've got people sleeping on the streets, it's an interesting question why they aren't matched up in the first place. But the fact remains, we have got empty houses, and they are being filled by people sleeping to make money. Is that right? Is it the best use of them? No, it's not the best use. Is it right? That's how society works.
Thank you. There was another hand up, was there a week?
I think the problem is basically compounded by, I'd say, a lack of honesty in the media. People cease to be refugees when they leave their first safe country. After that, they're classed as migrants, whether economic or not. That question seems to have not been tackled clearly by the media. And obviously, the scenes throughout Europe, the BBC is doing its usual thing. I'm not going to get into that discussion now. That's a completely discussion for another time. But yeah, basically speaking, and look, when it comes to the economic migrants, basically, I mean, if they're prepared to basically break the law to get into the country, I mean, I'm not talking about those that go from legitimate channels and, you know, Commonwealth people who have to actually have jobs and earn more than 25,000 a year. I'm talking about the people in the same gap that are prepared, fully prepared to break the law. You know, I mean, well, if they're prepared to break the law, they're basically, they're not migrants, they're just basically lawless people that would do that. You know, I mean, there's an awful lot of conflation on the issue, and I do think there needs to be some clear-cut definitions and segregations as to what class certain people fall into.
Thank you,
Simon.
Not in like a German law investigation serious kind of way, but in the sense of actually the danger now is actually you can't turn on the news without seeing at some point in the news item the issues of Syria and refugee fighting and migration coming up, because actually it's become for them a very newsworthy story. And it's good that it's been covered. The danger, as you say, is how it's happened. Since at the moment it's almost like a fly on the documentary just watching one refugee and one migrant moving from one place to another. It's not about the broader issue, it's not about what can be done to help, it's not about what help is being provided. And I think those other aspects need to be covered as well. So the full picture is given, so everybody's aware of the broader picture, not simply just seeing people moving from one spot to another.
I think you're right there, because what viewers to me get is a saturation point with how much they can take in at the misery and the scene. And I think a lot of it with the media, particularly the BBC, is that they've got that many reporters out there that have to cover a story that they feel that's what the public want. Well, I don't think the public actually believes that. They don't want what's been said, really, is how can we get out of this? How can we find a way through the problem? Because we can't give them that answer. The public, it's government, elected governments, the UN, as you said, and all the other organisations should be able to come up with a plan. And that's where everything goes wrong, isn't it? And you're right, the gentleman there was on about where people, when they end up breaking the law to get into the country, well, they certainly aren't. Refugees, we are talking about, and that's the difference, it is about this particular crisis and what we can do to help those helpless people.
Thank you. Okay, just very quickly, we're running out of time. So, an opportunity finally, are we satisfied with the responses of our politicians?
Okay,
yes. Yes, broadly speaking, you are satisfied. Okay, we've reached the end. Thank you very much. I'm going to very shortly invite Gray, our principal guest, who wants to say a word before Councillor Brady also says a few closing remarks as well. But could we just give a round of applause, please, for our... And thank you all as well. Gray.
This is the third one of these I've had the privilege to attend, and I've got to say I think this is the best one to do in terms of student interaction. I've got there's been some cracking questions, but also there's been some really positive debate as well, which is what essentially what this event is about. I do hope you're able to take something away from today, experiencing the great surroundings, but also to be engaged in an activity such as this, which is very much about developing your own communication skills as well. I think it's really pleasing to see such a wide breadth of students here today. We've got electricians, we've got apprentices, we've got journalists, we've got students on A-levels, we've got students from business, travel. Really good. Great to see interaction from all those areas as well. I thought the question on the city of culture was fascinating, really, and just to confirm that the college is at the heart of the planning for the city of culture celebrations. We do meet regularly with Martin and his team, and we are committed to contribute towards what will be, I think, around 4,000 volunteers that Martin and his team will be looking for going forward. And we will be providing some education and training as well to the square, exactly what forward steering is about. But hopefully after that, we'll actually see a few more hands go up once we all know what that entails. I think a lot of the questions that we've had today have been directed towards our councillors in terms of what are you going to do? What is your party? What is the government going to do with the whole city of Forest? I think we need to take on board what Councillor Brady was talking about as well, in terms of actually every one of us has got a responsibility to make the difference. It's not somebody else's job to get us a job or to make our life better. We've all got a responsibility to contribute towards that. So when we leave today, we can all think also about not just what other people are going to do for the city of Hull. As citizens of Hull, what are we going to do? What contribution are we going to make to the city? But also, what contribution will we make to make sure the city of culture does have a lasting legacy post 2017? It's the guys who are here making it happen now who will leave the city, and it will be down to us to make sure that legacy is maintained. When the eyes of the world are on the city during 2017, we all contribute to making sure that it's seen in the best possible light, that we celebrate what a great city we've got.
Thanks, Greg.
Councillor Brady?
Yeah, I'm sure when people walk up, when you solve all you walk up this morning, you think, oh, it's going to be a great day today. We're going to listen to politicians. It's not the greatest thing on anybody's agenda coming towards the weekend. But to actually go through a whole range of different issues and to be able to express your views is what you should do. And hopefully there are people who will represent the city like us, maybe in this audience, who will go through similar routes and end up making decisions on and having to sit here and answer to students in 30 years' time. You know, you just don't know where your life's going to lead to. I hope anyway, even if you aren't being satisfied with the answers, that it leads to debate outside of this room, at the college or in the community or whatever, as to, you know, what is life like, how should you get improvements, and to actually speak up for yourselves. And the one way that you can certainly make a big effect is what I said in the first instance, is registering and voting and showing that your satisfaction or disgust for governments, for parties. But at least, whether you're voting for the party I represent, or Mike's, or John's, is actually to say, this is what we think about you. We don't particularly like you, or we do. I will certainly support this principle, get involved. And there's people available to, if anybody wants to register for voting at future elections, and I'd urge you to do that. There is also tea and coffee outside in the foyer. If you want a drink before you leave. And finally, I hope you have a good weekend, and I'm pleased that you've come today and taken part, and I hope you've enjoyed yourself. Thank you.
So thanks everyone. So refreshments out the back here, and also our
spring to the ball.